Well, an icon is anything classic, anything that's timeless. It'll never go out of fashion. So when something is like that, you can say that's icon. Well, the motto, we're not airing dirty laundry, we're washing it. It's kind of like the Wendy Williams effect, because she has a way of getting to the story. And a lot of people think she's rude. A lot of people think that she's destroying lives when she does that. But my whole thing is, you cannot be free unless you come clean. So I thought a fun way to display what I do on my show is, I'm not airing dirty laundry, because I'm not trying to disrespect anybody. I'm just trying to get to the truth, and the truth shall set you free. It's my last season, because I think after this season, I've done all I could do. I'm not trying to stay in Springfield my whole life either. And so after this season, I think I will have interviewed everybody that's interesting to me. And from there, I like to move on to bigger and better things. When I first got my television show, I wanted to do radio initially, but I went to all the radio stations in town and they stopped me. They said I didn't have enough experience, so I needed to build a portfolio. So from there, I did my own thing. So now they see what I can do, what I'm capable of, and if this show so happens to become syndicated, I'll roll with that, but I'm not trying to be in Springfield. How many alter egos do I have? I don't think I know myself. There is Vincent Tenille, there's Alexander Jose, there's Charlotte Boy, there's Vance, which is a tribute to Beyonce. That's four. I think that's, oh, there's Langston, so that's five. You gotta have alter egos or you'll go crazy. I dyed my hair blonde because it was black for 23 years and I got bored. I dyed my hair right after I was in a car accident last year. So I could have died, so I'm like, okay, I'm alive, I need to feel alive. So I need something to pop, something colorful, something to let people know I'm here. So blonde is a big contraction from black. So I went the brightest I could go. If I wanted to do white, I'd do white hair, but it didn't take. The biggest challenges as a television host is, for one, getting people to show up on time. For two, back in the day, it used to be that you didn't want to offend people. You wanted to make them comfortable. Now everybody kind of wants you to do the reality television route, which means you have to act a fool to get people's attention. So the biggest challenge is, as a host, finding that balance, edutainment, as I call it. Or I used to call it educated ratchetness. What is it? Educated ratchet television. So I don't want people to just be bored, but I also don't want them to just think I'm all about cooning and buffoonery. I do want there to be a message, but I have to find that balance of what do the audience want, what do they respond to. So feedback is important. I do listen to my audience, so I have to know when to listen to them and when they may be wrong. The biggest challenge being a black man in America is basically trying to figure out what it's all about. I believe in reincarnation, so I believe we've been here before. I believe that we're here for a reason. So we signed up for a contract. We know the life we were going to live before we got here. I know it sounds kind of crazy and offbeat, but just stay with me. Being a black man in America means, what is the lesson in all of it? What is the lesson in racism? What is the lesson in the struggle and the hardship? Because it's not in vain. So it's not so much that I have a problem being a black man in America, because I love being black and I am a man. I just want to know, what does it all mean when we're on our deathbed? It has to mean something. The most embarrassing thing I've done was probably when Dr. Ben Carson came out with his movie. And I'm a big fan of Dr. Carson. And I wanted to be in the movie, so I took it upon myself to send my resume in, and I blowed up one of my pictures to 8x10 to send to the Johns Hopkins Hospital, thinking, oh, he may get this and I may get a phone call. When I think about that now, that was silly and foolish. There was no way that man was gonna put me in his movie, but I tried. I do not. I always wanted to adopt. I wanted to adopt 5 kids, actually. Teenagers, because I think once a child is in the foster care, after a certain age, nobody wants them, and I think that's whack. I think we should all make an effort. Everybody should adopt, or at least try foster care, see if it's for you, but I don't want children of my own. I'm not too big on leaving a legacy. I think that's overrated, and I think children cause karma. Like I said, going back to reincarnation, if you keep having children, in essence, you're just bringing yourself back to Earth. I think I'm done with Earth for a while after this life. I'm gonna do it right the first time. I am most proud of my show, and this interview is over. Good morning, noon or night icons. We do have a special guest with us today. It is Sam 250 Johnson of Keep It 200 Network. How are you doing today?
I'm doing real good.
Okay, you know I'm not one to stall or hold time. Last year, you were supposed to be a guest on my show.
Right.
You were scheduled as the first guest.
Right.
You ended up being arrested.
Right. And you was one of the first people that I called and said,
yes.
Man, I'm sorry. I ain't gonna be able to make it and everything like that, or what happened. But I remember that I was mad when I was in the back seat about that.
I was mad too. I was livid.
Yeah, I was like, dang, Aaron gonna think that I stalled him out.
Well, what happened was you ended up being pulled over.
Right.
And what was the reason for that?
Well, they pulled me over basically saying that I didn't use my signal within 100 feet, switching lanes, when that's not even a law to start with. Mm-hmm. Only way that that's a law is if you are turning into a business or a driveway, or if you're turning off a street, that's a law. So what they pulled me over for and put in their paperwork wasn't correct at all.
Okay, so how do you go from being pulled over to arrested?
Well, they said I was resisting arrest. I didn't want to get out the vehicle to sign the ticket.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew that what I did was not wrong, was not breaking the law and things like that. And I told them that I wasn't going to get out the car to sign a ticket, that you can get a ticket to me right here through the window. And I signed it. And, you know, it wasn't until then that the officer had told me, you know, well, as we kind of jawed back and forth, the officer had told me that, you know, you're under arrest. And then that's when I got out the car and I was arrested. But that's not resisting arrest either. If mm-hmm. you didn't say I was under arrest yet.
Right.
Not until you said it is when I got out the car. But you asked me to sign your ticket and get out the car, which I didn't want to do because I know that was just leading to basically a drug situation that they wanted to get involved in.
So you were able to prove yourself to be innocent through videotaping it, correct?
Correct.
That was, okay. Yeah. So it ended up being a big news story. And I guess the police officers weren't aware that you could videotape.
Right.
Okay, so that case dragged on for like a couple of months.
Yeah, it was like actually like 10 months.
10 months, okay. And you just got acquitted when?
July, it was like in July, July 23rd or something like that.
Okay, so what do you want people to know about, can we video record? Can we do that? Is that legal?
Yeah, it is legal that you can video record. But you also have to be educated when you're recording. You know, a lot of times some people, when they're in a situation with an officer, you know, we want to get a little loud. Or we might use our gestures as our body language, kind of out of control. That's not how you want to record, because they are in the right of, maybe you had a gun, maybe you had a weapon. They really don't know. So, but if you're being respectful about it, recording, talking, being how we got a calm manner going on right now when you're talking dialogue with the officer, then you can record and you're not breaking no law in any form or fashion. But the state's attorney, you can still be arrested. This is where everything still gets funny.
Okay.
You can still be arrested in general. Only thing is that the prosecutor won't prosecute it and charge you. So the game plays more to where you can get arrested. Now, as you get arrested, you pay your bond money. After you get out, your bond money, you got to keep coming to court or whatever till they drop it. Or they might ask you to pay a fine or whatever else. Now, you're innocent across the board. But, hey, if we can get you to pay a fine, that's what we're going to do. So, as we see, you know, our judicial system is just counting and collecting more money, thousands of dollars every day, off false charges on all citizens.
So, is this incident one of the reasons you began Keep It 200?
This wasn't one of the reasons. This is a reason why, but this wasn't one of the reasons why starting to Keep It
200. So, what's the story behind Keep It 200? Because we've seen the shirts. You're wearing it today.
Right, right.
I didn't know who you were at first. Two years ago, I said, who is this man? I don't know him. He keeps coming down my Facebook timeline.
Right.
What is Keep It 200?
Keep It 200 is basically just saying it. Raw and uncut content, not in a negative way, but in a positive way. Standing up, speaking your rights, you know, equality, your voices, you know, that's what Keep It 200 is about. You know, we've been keeping it 100 for so long, and I feel like there's just been too much icing on the cake. So, you know, it's time to take some icing off, and we need to tell more truth. You know, we need to have more honor and respect and loyalty, you know, towards people, what's going on. Just say it.
Okay, but that still doesn't tell me what the organization is.
The organization, we are a media company.
Okay.
Overall, media and entertainment is what we're doing. We're building a social media app. We already have one. We go off and on the app world at times, but we're building a phase three right now where we're getting ready to drop the app and the website.
Okay, so what happened to the first app?
The first app, well, when you're doing independent business, you don't have the budget like big companies do to stay consistent. So the first app, we end up having like 5,000 downloads that we had got on the market. And after a while, just like your monthly things that you have going on, that you have to keep it on the market, the whole maintenance, all those expenses, you know, that was getting a little high for us on the first app and stuff. So we was going to app two, so we took it down. We kind of renew it all the time until we get to that point to where we find that one that, you know, that takes off. So it's like trial and error right now.
Do you feel that it's necessary to have an app? I mean, there's so many other branches of media you could go to: Instagram, Facebook, Vine, Tumblr.
Right.
What's the difference about the app?
The difference about our app is that we deal with those areas as well, all those networks. But we also want to have our own app and network because we can control that ourselves. There's no other company that's controlling that information, you know. Having our own app, that's what everybody's into on the phone in the mobile world, is having an app. So having an app is having a network, having a network and having a database to be able to get in tune with our people when we want to.
Okay. Because when you first explained the Keep It 200 concept to me, you said it was sort of like the younger version of the Urban League.
You said the younger version of the Urban League?
You told me that.
I don't know about the Urban League thing.
Because you said it was something like the younger version of the Urban League or the NAACP.
I think that's the commission movement.
No, it was you.
No, I'm not saying it wasn't me. I'm saying that's what you, if this is with the Urban League and NAACP type capacity of work, that's the commission. That's a group, another organization.
So commission is not Keep It 200.
No.
Okay, this is where people like me get confused.
No, the commission is not Keep It 200. The commission is a whole nother like political community citizen type organization.
Okay, so how do you plan on keeping it separate? And so people like me know the difference. Because it's just not me. Many people, when I told people I were having you on the show, they were like, okay, Keep It 200, Keep It 200. Nobody ever mentioned commission.
Right.
Do people even know there's a difference?
People do know, but the people, I guess you can say, who's within that rim of, what I want to say, level that we're pushing, think about it, everybody's not into the political thing. Everybody's not into unity and working together with our community and stuff. Mm-hmm. So you have a slim area of people who know about that, but we're pushing it to grow, to get out there bigger and bigger. But a lot of people don't know about it.
Okay. You need to have some t-shirts made about that. Well, the whole thing with the whole unity, I have an issue with this whole unity thing. Because every time black people get aboard the diversity and unity theme, we always end up on the short end of things.
Right.
We never come out on top.
Right.
Because we live in a country where capitalism rules. So in order for that to thrive, somebody has to be on the bottom.
Right.
So who's going to be on the bottom if we all join together?
Well,
we already know the answer, but I just want to know your answer.
If we, there's two ways we look at that, depending on how you answer the question, asking the question. One way is it doesn't necessarily have to be a bottom. It can actually be a whole middle ground.
How?
And that's if we do it in the reality, the right way, the truthful way. Now, if we do it in a way where we're doing unity, but like you said, we know it's still going to be a bottom, 9 times mm-hmm. out of 10, we're going to be at the bottom. But if we're talking about a reality and true type model that can really be done, if you think about when you take greed out of a situation, take greed out of the heart and the minds of people, you get more common ground to the standpoint to where even if I'm a person where I'm worth $1 million, but maybe this year or the next couple of years, I might need to make 800 or 700,000 for these other people to be able to have more money, more tax money or something goes towards their way, which brings them up. Now, we're still at a standpoint to where we're not here yet, mm-hmm. but we're gradually, over years of time, trying to get there. So you take the greed out the top, which brings you down, and you bring your bottom up, and we get to a point to where it's a middle ground. Now, that's not saying no. It's not the whole riches and fame and everything mm-hmm. involved in it. But it's really more of a comfortable life, and that's the life that we're supposed to be living. So it's not that way. It can't happen. It's just going to take a nice period of time.
Who in their right mind is going to take away from their own bank account to give to other people? That sounds like the Robin Hood theory.
Well, the people will force that. The people will make that decision happen like that. Everything is through the people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. So everybody knows you are a preacher's kid.
Yeah.
Everybody knows your father.
Right.
Reverend Silas Johnson.
Right.
Okay. Growing up in that atmosphere mm-hmm. and living the life that you live, going through different experiences, what is your faith?
My faith?
Currently.
My faith, I look at faith in a different perspective than majority. Now, coming up, I think I probably was under the regular traditional way because I was taught that way. I guess you could say Baptist and all that type of, I was taught that way. That's what I seen coming up. But as I got older and started researching and studying more for myself, my faith, the traditions type changed. I believe in God. I believe in gods, and I believe in positive spirits. That's my faith. I don't really look at it the same traditional way that majority looks at it. So I feel like, I have relationships, and we all have the features to have the relationships that taking advantage of our relationship with nature, with grass, with water, with sun, with the oxygen. All those things are like religious and faith perspectives that I mold together of what I represent and how I look at what you consider faith.
So you're saying your parents got it wrong?
I'm not necessarily saying that they got it wrong. I just don't agree with totally how they look at it. But that's not saying that's wrong, because I could be wrong.
Do you feel that religion and faith is holding back the Black community?
I'll definitely say that. Because of how we look at it and how we've been taught for so many years. So with faith, we'll hold back on a lot of things mm-hmm. because we're waiting on this God of how certain people look at it and this Jesus to come and save us and make everything right, which you might as well keep waiting if that's the case.
Mm-hmm.
That's my opinion. But at the same time, we look at other cultures who believe in a power, just like we believe in a higher power,
mm-hmm.
but they don't believe in the same traditional ways of how we do, because they don't worship it the same way that we do, as we can see where we are today. They take advantage of what's going on in the world. You can't knock them. Mm-hmm. They're doing what they're supposed to do.
Right.
The ones who's just sitting here looking up and just waiting on this God to come and save us and take us out of our struggles and take us out of our poverty and everything else. So I do believe that religion and faith of how it's kind of being educated to people is hindering the Black African American race.
Okay. Now, your image seems to confuse a lot of people. Because one minute you're a community activist. Right. The next minute you're throwing parties at the Dirty South
right.
with half-naked women on the posters.
It's been a minute since you've seen that, something like that.
But it happened.
But it happened.
Yes. So are you saying we need to find the balance as a people? We need to be able to accept the balance of the devil and angel in us? Or because some people, they can't really grasp you.
Right.
Okay. I'm speaking for a lot of people right now.
Right.
It's just not my feelings.
I know,
okay.
I know.
All right. They seem to not know how to categorize you.
Right.
Because people are not as open-minded as we'd like them to be.
Right.
Truth be known. We have to box people. We have to put them in a category.
Right.
Are you wanting to be Martin Luther King? Are you wanting to be a David Banner?
Right.
Are you wanting to be Tavis Smiley? You know,
right.
where do you fit in this ball game?
Well, I think I'm under the sickness of bipolarism. You know.
As the rest of the Black community.
Yeah, bipolarism is what I call it.
Mm-hmm.
But we do have to find that balance. The first thing, like you said, between the devil in us and the, you know, and the godly in
mm-hmm.
us. I definitely believe in that. And you can't judge one, because the one thing we can't do is, I can't judge what's inside your heart.
Mm-hmm.
I can't judge what's inside your mind. I can make an assumption at it to think maybe what I might think you might be thinking or whatever else, but really and truly, I'll never understand what's inside of you, only you. So even if anybody wants to take it as a woman or something who might want to be a stripper or something
mm-hmm.
like that, that's not something that I would want my daughter to do or want a lady to do. But I don't know your circumstances of what's going on. I don't know what you're thinking. I don't know what's in your heart, you know, to that degree. So I can't judge you. But if you got good intentions in this worldly, to where, you know, you don't look at it as people, you know, like killing and raping and stuff like that. You just got common good in you. And, you know, from that standpoint, I can't judge you. So all I can say is let's meet on a common ground. So I think it's like what you said in the beginning, it's finding that balance. Because I find the devilish ways in me a lot, and I
mm-hmm.
find the godly ways. And I don't think that it just leaves and we're just godly. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe in that.
Well, it's hard to tell people not to judge, especially when we've been screwed over time and time and time again.
Right.
I think it's time we ought to start judging.
Right.
We need to know who people are. We need to know what they can do for us.
Right.
Why are you in the public eye? A lot of times, once people get attached to that fame
mm-hmm.
and they get a taste of money,
right. yeah.
they change.
Yeah.
So we can sit up here and say, we shouldn't judge, blah, blah, blah. No, I think it's time to judge.
Right.
So if you had to pick a side, I'm going to give you two names. You just pick.
Okay.
Which one are you more like? Okay, are you more like a, how should I say it? Malcolm X or a Martin Luther King, to make it easy?
That's not making it easy.
That's making it real easy.
I'm gonna tell you why it's not making it easy, because I'm both.
You can't be both.
Hold on, let me show you. I throw the tools up, because we're keeping peace,
mm-hmm.
which is Martin Luther King. But you also see us throw the tools up like this, because it can instantly turn to that. Because by any means necessary, I'm going to protect my community and everything else if it comes to that.
So you're not going to give us a real answer?
I just gave you the answer.
Because Malcolm could be peaceful too,
but the image
he put out there is not holding hands, gather around the kitchen table and pray.
Not.
What's your image you want to project?
Because
when we think of Martin, we think of this. When we think of Malcolm, we think of this.
Right.
Which one are you?
See, that I can't give you that answer because I'm both.
But you want us to trust you.
I'm both. That's really the honest answer that I can give you. That's the keep it 200 answer I can give you. Because if I say that I'm king,
mm-hmm.
and for everybody who's watching, who understands my understanding or know me for what I know and agree with certain tactics that X use, then it's kind of like, well, now you king now? You're a traitor? No, I believe in different tactics. I seen the picture out there where they had Gandhi out there. I mean, we don't want to get in that.
I don't like him.
I believe in tactics that he used. So to an extent, I'm Gandhi. Not all what he did, but I believe in certain things he did.
But you get what I'm saying. Image is important.
Right.
Because people cannot comprehend when you're all over the place. We think we've evolved into these great humans.
I think that's what we've been conditioned
to
think.
We haven't.
We've been conditioned to think we need to see which one you are. But mm-hmm. you really want that freedom. You really want that I'm this, I'm that, at times I'm this. Because that's the reality.
That is reality.
So, and that's what I'm pushing. That's the world that I live in up here, in a reality world. Sometimes it might work down here, sometimes it might not, but I'm gonna continue to live like that because I can go to sleep at night like that.
So it's your mission to uncondition people
right.
from being brainwashed.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Find that one won't give the heart to you. Have you ever closed your eyes and dreamed that they were there, and all you could do is wait for the day when they will care? Have you ever loved? Have you ever needed? No. Have you ever tried to find the words, but they don't come out right? Have you ever? What do I gotta do to get you in my arms, baby? What do I gotta say to get to your heart, to make you understand how I need you next to me? I gotta get you in my world, 'cause baby I can't sleep. Have you ever loved? No. Have you ever needed? So bad. Have you ever tried to find the words, but they don't come out right? Have you ever loved? Oh, have you ever needed? Have you you ever tried, baby? Have you ever tried, baby? I don't think you heard me. Heard the words to come out right. Mm. Have you ever?